Hello and welcome to Meet the Boss TV. What's the difference between design and style? And do enough marketers recognise the distinction? In this programme, we speak to legendary creative Dave Trott to find out. In part one of our interview with advertising legend, author and predatory thinker Dave Trott, we discovered why outthinking your rivals is essential in today's business environment, and why competition and failure are nothing to be afraid of. In this second instalment, he discusses why there's not enough creativity in the advertising industry and outlines the value in thinking differently. First in the crosshairs, marketing's obsession with digital.
So digital for me is like saying, what do you think about television? Or what do you think about talking pictures? Or what do you think about oil paintings? It's a medium. And it'll be as good or as bad as the people using the medium. And I haven't yet seen anything truly exciting and groundbreaking in that area. I've seen some new stuff done, and the new stuff, everybody grabs it, jumps on the bandwagon, and it's new for about a week until everybody's got it, and then you're back to having to outthink the competition again. That's kind of like when they started to put sponsor football shirts in football games. And I think everybody remembers the first sponsor of the club, so I'll remember Arsenal was JVC. But who is it now? I don't know. Maybe it's Emirates, because they've got a stadium called Emirates, so maybe that's who sponsors them. West Ham? I don't know. Manchester United? Chelsea? I don't know. Only one club I can tell you who were the sponsors, because they got it right, and that was Newcastle. Had Newcastle Brown as the sponsors, and that was perfect fit. But anything else is just, you remember, you know, novelty is just that, and it really isn't thinking, it's fashion. Like I said, that's not creative. That's just skirts are up this year. Let's all make our skirts short. Oh, hang on, skirts have gone down again. Let's all make them long. It's following the herd. It's not fashion.
What is an example of creative thinking in your opinion?
Anywhere. It's always contextual. So you would say in art, Duchamp was incredibly creative. I don't like him at all. I don't like punk. That was incredibly creative. I much prefer Picasso, who was also quite creative. Reinventing yourself is quite creative. So you'd say Dylan, who I do like, is quite creative. Madonna, who I don't like, was quite creative. They were constantly reinventing themselves and stepping out there each time, not knowing if it was going to be right or wrong. They were very exciting. Other than that, I like Norman Foster, but I don't think he's very creative. I like Jonathan Ive, but I don't think he's very creative. They're great stylists, but you wouldn't say they were creative. You'd say Bauhaus was much more creative, because what they're doing is refining what that was. Minimalism and form follows function. And I think refining a thing, you know, you could be a great stylist. It's not necessarily the same as... It's the difference between design and style. Design is solving a problem. Style is giving you a slightly new look at an existing answer to a problem. And I think that's where everybody's at now, not just in digital, but most everywhere, is giving you a slightly new look at as an existing answer to a problem, not solving the problem in a new way.
Can marketing be successful without being creative, if it is more style rather than innovation?
Sure, marketing traditionally is always successful by bashing people over the head with loads of money. For instance, if you take five million is a reasonable sized ad account, 10 million is a medium size, 15 million is starting to get to be a big ad account. How much do you think Direct Line spend on advertising? Let me tell you, Direct Line spent 83 million a year on advertising. That's 10% of the financial sector, which is 10% of the overall advertising sector. Now, at 83 million, you don't have to be any good. You can just bash the daylights out of everybody with 83 million. So if you've got that kind of money, you don't have to be creative. It's like having an army that's bigger than anybody else's. You don't have to be creative. It's like having a football club that has more money and more players and better players than anybody. You don't have to be creative. Now, the creative question is, how do you beat the people who are better than you, who've got more money than you, the clubs who've got more money than you? How did Brian Clough win the European Cup twice, back-to-back, with Nottingham Forest? You couldn't even find Nottingham Forest on the map. He did it twice, back to back. No other club before or since has done that. What Shankly did at Liverpool took him from nowhere in the second division to the massive force they are nowadays. That's creativity, not just wandering into an already existing big club with a ton of money, spending a ton of money. That's, I mean, that's successful, but it's not creative. So creativity and success are not synonymous.
And with creative industry legend Sir John Hegarty recently denouncing most modern advertising as boring, the need for greater creativity in the profession has never been more important.
It's a better world for all of us when everybody's more creative, because it's more exciting for all of us, rather than just doing the same old thing, just same old formula, waiting until somebody else does it and then rushing and copy them. What you'd like to see is, and ideally, to look everywhere for creativity, not just only inside digital. So that's a very narrow place, like it would be with advertising or anything else. That's a very narrow place to look for creativity. So just take the concept that creativity is an adjective, not a noun. Creativity can be anywhere. The so-called creative department actually isn't very creative at all. And creative is a measure of how you do your job, whether you're a bus driver, a teacher, a footballer, whatever. Creativity is a measure of how excitingly and innovatively you do your job. Wouldn't it be a more interesting and exciting world if we all did that?
So creativity isn't about content. I think a lot of people maybe think of those two things as interchangeable.
I hear all these buzzwords, and my general feeling about buzzwords is the more you use them, the further you move away from understanding what they mean. Better to find out what the buzzword means and use the real words for it. So whatever content means, use the real words for that. And whatever storytelling means, use the real words for that. And in our business, you can really spot the non-creative people, because they are the people who are so scared stiff of being left out, they must use the buzzwords at every opportunity to prove they're one of the cognoscenti. Yeah? I usually find the quality of the brief is inversely proportional to the length of the words used. And so people who've had a great idea, Einstein said, you haven't really understood it until you can explain it to an 11-year-old. If you've had a great idea, you want to put it in the simplest possible language so everybody can get it. If you've had a not very good idea that you're quite ashamed of, you're going to put it in complicated language to dress it up. People are scared stiff to say, I don't know, in a meeting. Usually the power is in saying, I don't know. Then you'll walk out of the meeting knowing more than you walked in, or you'll expose the fact that the person using those words doesn't know either. So I think ignorance is a great place to come from. Enlightened ignorance.
Sure, so that taking that more simplified, more direct approach is a form of creativity in an industry that is kind of swimming in these buzzwords.
The public don't use those buzzwords. The public don't understand those buzzwords. We are much closer to the public if we talk in the language the public uses. If we force ourselves to talk and think like them, we've got a much better chance of getting a handle on how they talk and think. Rather than, if it's all buzzwords, we're doing our job for other people who do our job, which is what most advertising certainly is. Advertising being done for other people in advertising.
As you look around you, what are you currently most excited about in marketing? And, you know, what are you most concerned with?
The fact that things going viral is taken off as something special. Before it was ever called viral, it was called getting in the language. Was what you always tried to do. Getting in people's language, getting people to pick up your line and use your line and say it in their daily lives was what you always tried to do. So nowadays, more than ever, I see people ashamed to be in advertising, so they're ashamed to use the name of the product anywhere in the ad, except virtually subliminally at the end. So you've got ads that we don't even know what the ads are for. Forget selling. We're not in this. Advertising isn't in the business of selling. Marketing is in the business of selling. Advertising is always been in the business of getting it in the language. And at the moment, we're so confused about what are we doing. Are we in social media? Are we in going viral? Are we in marketing? Are we? Everybody is so confused about what the job of advertising is that nobody does the job. And we are there to amplify the marketing message. And nobody's doing that at the moment. Everybody in the creative, so-called creative department thinks they're making little films to win awards, and for them awards is more important than anything. And in the marketing department, they think everything is brand. But meanwhile, I don't hear consumers talking about advertising. I don't hear anybody whistling songs or repeating catchphrases. I don't see it repeated in the newspapers. I don't see comics using it on the TV. So it just isn't in the language. That's the massive opportunity, and that's also the big problem.
Sure, so that's the big opportunity. How do we address it?
We start to know what our job is, and we stop being embarrassed about what our job is. Stop pretending we are making little short films for Hollywood, and stop worrying about awards given to us by other people who are only in the advertising business, and leave marketing to do what marketing does, and realise what our job is to do is to give consumers something that they can take into their own lives and have fun with. The last time I heard anything like that was my sister called me up from New York and said, there's a great commercial out in New York that only plays on Wednesdays for Geico, and it's called Hump Day, and it's about a camel on hump day. And the line is, if you save money with Geico, you'll be happier than a camel on hump day. And she started repeating it down the phone, and my daughter went and looked up it on YouTube, and she showed it to me, and now she's shown it, sent it to everybody we know, and I've sent it to everybody I know and put it on Twitter, because this is the funniest thing I've seen, happier than a camel on hump day. And it's all about hump day being Wednesday, getting over the hump of the week. And if you save money on Geico, you'll be... Literally everybody's repeating it. I hear the line being repeated. In this country where we don't even have Geico, I'm talking about Geico, and I'm talking about how much money you can save. And it's gotten into word of mouth here amongst everybody who's sitting. And we don't even have it here. Now that's powerful.
For more fantastic interviews directly related to your business, be sure to explore Meet the Boss TV.